Good evening. I hereby call the 7 p.m. Finance Committee meeting to order for Monday, March 6, 2017. Before we go into the first agenda item, councilors, please be aware that Councilor Cruz is actually outside of the Commonwealth. He's unable to attend tonight. He's here in spirit, I believe, as he's sunning himself in the Caymans.
Some spirits.
Yeah. Madam Clerk, if we could go on to agenda number one, please.
Order that the mayor is authorized to grant an easement to the town of Kingston in, across, over, under, along, and upon a portion of city-owned land situated on the westerly side of Lake Street in Kingston for purposes related to a culvert and for stormwater management. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Larry Rowley, Commissioner, Department of Public Works, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent, Engineer, Ossie Jordan, Chair, Water Commission, Matthew Darish, Superintendent, Kingston Water Department.
Please, someone come before. Mr. Jordan, good evening. How are you?
Good evening.
Give a statement for the committee?
Yeah, basically, this is just short and sweet. They have a sewer that they're doing some work on. It's under some property that we own down there, and we're just giving them the easement so they can go ahead and do that work. That's the short and sweet. I mean, you had the long reading of it, and I won't be bored, you know, say all that again. If you have any questions, let me know.
Drain?
Yeah, drain work. I'm sorry.
Could you clarify, is it a permanent or a temporary easement?
Temporary.
Permanent.
It is permanent? Okay, I'm sorry.
Permanent easement?
Yeah.
Councilors, it means it would run in perpetuity. Councilors, any questions for Mr. Jordan?
Make a motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made properly. Second, favorable recommendation. Back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, motion carries. Thank you very much. Favorable
Thank you
recommendation.
Very much.
Back to the full city council. Madam Clerk, agenda item number two, please.
Order that the City Council authorize the acceptance and expenditure of the total grant in the amount of $150,000 from Commonwealth of Massachusetts Executive Office of Public Safety and Security, SFY 2017 Massachusetts Municipal Public Safety Staffing Grant to City of Brockton Fire Department, SFY 2017 Massachusetts Municipal Public Safety Staffing Grant Fund. These funds will be used for overtime necessary to maintain staffing levels. No match required. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Chief Michael F. Williams, Brockton Fire Department.
Good evening, Chief. How are you?
And good evening. How are you?
Good. Thanks for being here tonight.
You're welcome.
Do you have a statement or a clarifier or anything?
This is the third year that we've received this grant. It's luckily built over the 3 years. So we're just looking to accept this $150,000.
Thanks, Chief.
Motion to recommend favor.
Second.
Motion made properly. Second, favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, motion carries. Thank you, Chief. Favorable recommendation back to the full council. Go to number three, Madam Clerk, please.
Order that the City Council authorize the acceptance and expenditure of the total grant in the amount of $14,039 from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Executive Office of Public Safety, FY17 Student Awareness of Fire Education, SAFE, grant, $10,643, and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Executive Office of Public Safety Fiscal Year 2017 Senior Safe Grant, $3,396, to City of Brockton Fire Department Fiscal Year 2017 Student Awareness of Fire Safety Education, SAFE, and Senior Grant Fund. These grant funds will be used for fire safety education program. No match required. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Chief Michael F. Williams, Brockton Fire Department.
Chief, any statement at all?
Again, with this grant we've actually received for several years now. It goes for the education for the students in the schools and also the seniors at the Council on Aging and in the high-rises.
Move for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made, properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, that motion carries. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you very much.
Madam Clerk, that's favorable back to the full council. Before we read agenda number four, councilors, just want to let you know, point of information, Chief Crowley did send me an email over the weekend. He had indicated that he had met with the mayor and he had met with the CFO, and the fact that he was only listed once on one agenda item, he wanted to know if he could relieved from attending tonight, because Mr. Condon can answer this. I told him yes, but I also did a caveat that if any counselor on this committee would like him to appear in the future, or if there's any objection to that, he would need to be present at future meetings. I just wanted to let you know. If you could read number four, please.
Order that the City Council authorize the acceptance and appropriation of the total grant in the amount of $12,784 from U.S. Department of Justice Fiscal Year 16 Bulletproof Vest Program Grant to City of Brockton Police Department Fiscal Year 16 Bulletproof Vest Program Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Chief John Crowley, Brockton Police Department.
Mr. Condon, good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Councilors, this is for a grant for just over $12,000, just under $12,700, actually. And the funds are for purchasing bulletproof vests for the police department, and there is a match required, but the match is coming from allocated grant funds.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made, favorable recommendation, properly seconded. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, that motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Madam Clerk, it's a favorable recommendation back to the full council. If we go to the next agenda item, please.
Order that the City Council authorize the Mayor to execute the Administrative Consent Order, ACO, issued by the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection, MassDEP, relating to Monoposset Pond. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Philip C. Nizrala, City Solicitor, Larry Rowley, Commissioner, Department of Public Works, David Norton, Water Sewer Contract Administrator, City of Brockton, Millie Garcia Serrano, MassDEP, Southeast Region.
Attorney Federer, for the record, if you could state why you're appearing tonight, in what capacity?
I'm appearing on behalf of the city, on behalf of Philip Nisrella. This ACO predated the time when I was still working for the City of Brockton, and I helped negotiate the agreement, so I'm most familiar with it.
And you work now, currently?
Mead, Tellerman, and Costa, Millis, Massachusetts.
Thank you, attorney.
Thank you.
Any statement?
So we're here tonight asking for authority to execute the ACO. We've negotiated with DEP over the past several months regarding this asset that we use, namely Monoposset Pond. Recently, Monoposset Pond, specifically the western portion of Monoposset Pond, has been suffering under algae blooms. As a consequence, the DEP came to the city to discuss the situation, and it resulted in this ACO. Essentially, the reason for the algae blooms have nothing to do with the city, to the extent that it's driven by nutrient loading. And that occurs, obviously, from residential, the neighborhood surrounding the pond, as well as agricultural uses that feed nutrients into the pond. But what a recent scientific study showed was that our use of the water of Monoposset Pond to feed Silver Lake slowed the recovery of the pond. So we entered in this ACO, and essentially what it's doing is it's asking the city, or directing the city, to have constant flow go over Stumbrook Dam in the hopes that that will help to clean the pond. And the city is obliged to study these water resources and prepare a plan to present to DEP so that we can have an effective way to try to clean the pond. And essentially, those are the terms of the agreement. I can entertain any questions that you may have. DEP is here tonight to speak on the topic.
Thank you, Attorney Federer. Councilor Falwell.
Good evening. Nice to see you.
Nice seeing you.
It's boring reading, but it's necessary. So I guess my questions will go towards where do we go from here, and what might it cost the city? I notice that we're going to enter into an agreement to guarantee a certain flow at Stumbrook Dam.
Mm-hmm.
Is that going to require construction, new technology,
No.
or is the existing dam as constructed sufficient? I guess that would be my first question.
The existing dam is sufficient. We just have to lower essentially the sluice gate to capture and calculate the amount of flow that's going to be going over the dam. We do that during diversionary periods now because we're required by legislation to do that when we're diverting into Silver Lake. So we do it as a matter of course anyway. Now we're just going to be doing it constantly. So I don't foresee infrastructure costs. Where the costs lie are in the creation of the reports. So there are two reports that are going to be created as a result of this, or actually one report is being created new, and a second report is being modified. There was an existing comprehensive water management plan that had been created several years ago. That is being modified to just, it's essentially being updated to reflect what current what water sources we have in place and how we use them. The water resource plan is going to dictate how we're using each of those water resources to ensure environmental protection measures are met.
Okay, and I noticed that one of the things cited in the report is that apparently there was a three-month period, I think it was January, February, March of 2016, when DEP said that, I guess the flow was insufficient and we didn't check it. Now, is that just because we didn't send someone down there? And so are we going to have a periodic program of inspection? And
Essentially, so on an average basis, we were compliant with 900,000 gallons going through the sluice gate. There were three instances of non-compliance, and it's because the gate is manually operated, so someone has to physically go out there on a daily basis, essentially, and adjust the gate. We are considering whether we should take measures to automate the gate, and it would make it much easier to deal with and also capture the data and respond more quickly. But for the moment, we're having someone go out to the gate every single day and check that level.
Okay, and this business about 70,000 cells per milliliter of cyanobacteria, are we going to do the testing? Is it expensive? How often are we going to have to do it? In other words, how are we going to ensure that we do, once we sign this, we really do have to live up to this morally, ethically, and legally? So who will do that, and any expenses involved?
So the 70,000 cells was, number one, a practice that the city had already been engaged in, because it's a health hazard if you're diverting when there are 70,000 cells. And I believe it's DPH that does the testing and notifies us, Brian, correct? It's DPH that does the testing and notifies us when those levels are reached.
Okay, so in summary, the good news is we're not the cause of it. There are a lot of reasons. I know there used to be around Mon Ponds at some businesses that did a lot of laundry, and I think the phosphorus went into the water, and Council Beauregard and Council Alley and I have been down in that area. So the good news is we didn't cause it, but we are going to have to be very meticulous going forward to make sure we meet the requirements of this ACO.
Yes, absolutely. We have to be meticulous, and it's a benefit to us because naturally we want to preserve our water resources, one of which is Mon Ponds at Pond. So it's in our interest to make sure that that pond's clean, just as it's in the interest of those who live around the pond to have a clean pond. So,
okay, and I guess the last question is, where are we with the update of the comprehensive water management plan? Is that, you know, 3 months away, 6 months away, or?
The deadline for submitting that plan is 6 months from the date of execution. I don't even think it will take that long, quite frankly, because there are only certain areas of the original comprehensive water management plan that have to be tweaked. And we're engaging our outside engineers to do that, and they're already quite familiar with the document. And that said, DEP has already agreed to work with us so we can minimize the costs associated with preparing that document by having a targeted list of issues to address. So the comprehensive water management plan is one. The other is the water resources management plan, which is going to be a new document, and that probably will take the entire period.
Okay, and I guess my last question, and I'll defer to the chair if this is not part of what we're discussing tonight, but some of us are concerned with the long-range water resource for Brockton. If there were a catastrophic event, either environmental or man-made, and Silver Lake were compromised, you're only getting 3.7 or 3.8 million gallons out of the desal plant. Do we have a plan in the offing to address Brockton's long-term water needs, particularly with housing increasing, and if something catastrophic occurred and we lost Silver Lake in the future, hopefully, are we looking at what our options might be, if you know?
So it's not a requirement of this ACO to deal with that issue. That said, we are going to look at this comprehensively and globally to consider, number one, which resources we should tap and when, including presumably our secondary source, that being Aquaria. And you're right, in order to grow, we have to, especially in light of this recent drought, we have to consider using Aquaria more frequently.
All right, well, thank you for your work on this. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think my question would go to Ms. Garcia Serrano.
Good evening. Thanks for being here.
Good evening.
Hi. So I just want to, I guess, get a round idea of what this is and kind of how Brockton might fit into a bigger kind of tapestry. So I see that this is the ACO specifically for Brockton because that's where we are and that's why we're here. But are there any other documents like this for any of the other surrounding towns that might draw from Monponset?
So, good evening and greetings. Millie Garcia Serrano, a service regional director for MassDEP in the Southeast region. This is a very unique situation because Brockton has water rights from that they date back to 1964.
Okay.
So basically what we're dealing with right now is to ensure that the issues that came in front of us, some of them stemming from 1995, 1997, old administrative consent orders, we closed those two instruments out by way of this new instrument that now has a path forward. DEP is very committed to ensuring that the city and the department works hand in hand to capture any kind of cost efficiencies. We are very intimately involved with every single issue that deals with water protection, water quality. We just went through a TMDL process that's a total daily maximum loading process, which is a very important step to identify other sources of potential nutrients loading and contributions. And furthermore, it was concluded that the city is not responsible for loadings per se, but rather through the operation of the sluice gate. As Attorney Fedorov explained, we can definitely do a better job to ensure that we have that constant flow that's needed. And honestly, it is a challenge, I think, regional-wise, because we just went through a very severe drought.
Mm-hmm.
The good news is that we're quickly recovering, and MassDEP continues to be informed in terms of the inches minus that we have currently at Silver Lake and other ponds. But again, I think this is going to be a very important step towards achieving the water protection. And I think with it comes some deadlines, but DEP is, again, committed to ensuring that we see you through so that we can move forward in a way that protects all's interests.
Okay. And so since this is, you know, unique to this particular situation, I guess I'm just trying to get an idea. So are there any other communities that kind of have the same issue with the increase in the nutrients in the towns?
But absolutely.
What's been the outcome of, you know, these agreements with those city and towns?
So basically the important piece here is to try to find pathways for eliminating the source. And the combination of a source elimination in addition to, for example, alum treatments and application of the treatments, MassDEP is pursuing, trying to assist with several constituency groups that are seeking state grants so that we can procure the necessary alum treatments and ensure that we can capture and sequester the nutrients.
This
is not unique to this particular pond or this community.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, that's good. I think maybe to Attorney Fedorov, thank you.
Sure.
Just one more question. I mean, we can't predict, you know, kind of what the outcome will be of some of the future reports that, you know, this requires us to draft. But I guess I'm just thinking, you know, we had this drought. We don't know if it'll come again. Is there anything that you can foresee, reasonably foresee, that might end up, not putting us, putting our back up against the wall, or that might end up binding us into something that we weren't prepared for? Is there any indication of that at all, or is this kind of all just routine?
So the really wonderful thing about this document is it binds us in most provisions only temporarily until we can have more science behind the solutions.
Mm-hmm.
So what it says, for example, I'll give you a for example, the constant flow of 900,000 gallons that's going through the sluice gate is a temporary measure until we have a full analysis of whether or not that's an effective solution to treating the, or to preventing the green algae from growing. So what we're going to do, and that's what our engineers are going to try to tell us, is they may say, you know what, it might be better to impound water and then do a larger flush.
A flush, mm-hmm. Okay.
It might be more helpful to do that. We're just not really sure at this moment. So that's the one wonderful thing about this document, is that it gives us a lot of flexibility once we have a better handle on the how our solutions or our attempts at solutions are working.
Got it. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor Barnes. Any other questions for any of the invited guests? I entertain a motion then.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Favorable recommendation was properly seconded. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, our motion carries. It's a favorable recommendation back to the full council. Thank you for everybody on that agenda for being here tonight. We appreciate it. Madam Clerk, number six, please.
Resolve to invite Mr. Paul Engel, the new executive director of the Brockton Public Library, to introduce and present ideas on the future of the library system to the City Council. Invited, Paul Engel, executive director, Brockton Public Library.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Engel, good evening.
Good evening.
Nice to meet you, and thank you for being here tonight. Congratulations on your new position as well.
Thank you, sir. I would just like to, being that I've been at the library for less than 3 months, instead of talking about my vision for the Brockton Library, I'd like to give you a rundown of who I am, my background, and some of the vision statements that I gave my team to think about over the course of the next several months. Is that good?
Yes.
Okay. I'm a musician, as most of you may know from reading the article in the Enterprise, with a background in what I call the American garage. I'm American music is my passion. American music sits on two pillars, if you will. The one pillar would be blues, and the other pillar would be gospel music. And from that, I could talk to you for the rest of the evening, but I won't. My academic background is I have a Bachelor of Music degree from the Berklee College of Music, and a Master's in Library Science from the University of North Texas. Professionally, I have 21 years of experience at the Berklee College of Music. The last 17 of those were as the director of the library, the Stan Getz Library. Some of the things that I bring to the table, I'm a very strong project manager, I'm a very good grant writer, and I'm very proficient at team building. As far as project leads, I have established and done two major library renovations at Berklee, and I also developed a graduate library in Valencia, Spain. Now, I talked about pillars, and I have two pillars of library science that really inform me when I make decisions. The first pillar would be the library as space. A library as space, meaning that the library is a place where anybody can go and engage the community. And ideas can be presented in a comfortable, in a safe, and a welcoming, and a respectful environment. That, to me, is an incredibly important thing. The second pillar is the library as crucible. And what I mean by that is when you step into a library, you often step in with one set of ideas or a set of beliefs. And in that space, in that sacred space, you burn those ideas away and you replace them with new ideas and new directions. And from there, and I gave this presentation in a broader, longer format to my staff, I asked my staff to think about three vision statements, or four vision statements, excuse me, that I have for libraries. For public libraries. The first vision for public libraries that I asked them to look at and think about was that public libraries shall be versatile physical and virtual spaces. Now, Brockton has a wonderful, beautiful library. You guys checked that box long before I got here. But I'm thinking about ways in which we can increase the visibility in the virtual world, make this library a 24-hour, 7-day-week, 365-day library. The second vision statement that I brought to my team was a vision for the public libraries that has a commitment to careful stewardships of all of our collections. Now, earlier today, I found out that at the War Memorial, there is also a library of artifacts and materials that directly relate to Brockton that are historic in nature. How do we take those collections and incorporate them, preserve them, and make them available to generations beyond our own? The third vision statement that I have is one of a public library that has librarians engaging patrons and community outreach. Again, Brockton is doing a very good job of that. People like Melise with her ESL program. My question and my challenge is, how do we increase that? How do we increase our outreach to our community? How do we bring them in, and how do we reach them and evangelize the library to them? And what services can we provide? And finally, the future of public libraries will be a place where innovative curation of technology, both past, present, and future, will happen. Technology can be anything. The glasses I'm wearing are technology. Most of us think of technology as being some handheld device. We need to look at all of it. And one thing I challenge my staff, and I challenge you, is that the New York Public Library, through Sprint, got a grant to offer thousands of electronic devices, PDAs, hotspots, to check out to the patrons of New York City. Oh. Now, I know that the Brockton system has done something with Sprint through the school system, and I think that's a great idea. How do we broaden that? How do we include not just the schools and our students, but the community at large in Brockton that may not have the resources or funds available to provide their own PDAs, their own hotspots? How do we get that out to them? So those are the ideas that I put forth to my staff about a month ago, and those are the ideas I'm putting forth to you today. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Engel, thank you. And I do believe this is Council Beauregard's resolve, correct?
Yes.
Do you have any questions
or
follow-ups? Well,
the goal was to have Paul introduce himself this evening, everyone to understand, you know, where he was coming from, some plans and some ideas he's already worked on. And he's been out in the community already. I mean, he's been here a little more than 60 days and already done some scene to some painting inside the Brockton Main Library. He's already met several individuals at a park, whether it be the superintendent of schools, Kathleen Smith, or several other individuals at a part of this community, George Rotte, that's working on the downtown, TDI fellow. We've had a lot of positive interaction. So that was the goal this evening, is for everyone to meet him and realize that we do have a director and we're pretty excited as a community. So thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Council Barnes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hello.
Hello.
Welcome to the city of Brockton. Welcome to the library.
Very much.
You mentioned there a little bit in your narrative that, you know, some of the things that you highlighted that you recognize and you know, celebrate about the Brockton Public Library and the collaboration that it's doing with the city and residents and things. But I guess I kind of wanted to find out, so in your 60 days, you know, day two, what was your initial assessment of the library system as a whole?
Day two, that's a good question. on day two, I think I was probably still trying to figure out the Munis system, or whatever it's called. I think whenever I walk into a new library or anything, you know, anything, I really just kind of try to figure out how things are vibing. How to me, libraries are kind of living entities, and I get that from the library philosopher Ranganathan, Sergey Ranganathan, and libraries are living things. Mm-hmm. So the first thing I really did, and what I'm still doing, is trying to figure out how the library, how it feels, how it hangs. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And my impression is that it's a place where there's a lot of people that go to that library that really don't have anywhere else to go. And that to me is a crucial part of why we exist. Is we exist for the people who can't go or don't have any other place to go. I drove by, I think it was East Branch the other day. It was closed, mm-hmm. but I saw a small kid, maybe a teenager, 14 years old, sitting outside of that library. And he was sitting there and he was on his phone. And I stopped. I said, hey, what are you doing? Oh, I'm just, the library's got Wi-Fi. I'm using the bleed through.
Hmm.
That's what we need. We need to engage those people, and we need to give them what they're looking for and what they need, desperately need.
Okay, interesting. Thank you. Thank you very much. Welcome.
Councilor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Engel. Welcome to Brockton, and well to have you here. My question, in your presentation, you mentioned that you're grant writer, so that really sparked my thoughts. So how soon will you start writing grants? Because the saddest thing is to hear that, you know, that a library has to close. And I have children in public school, and our libraries and some of the schools were closed, and that's kids need our libraries, so we don't want to hear that any of them have to close. So what are some of your plans?
Well, very concretely, I've met with this state grant writer, I don't know if I'm calling him the right thing, Paul Yamano. We actually talked on the phone today. I found a grant from the Massachusetts Historical Commission about restoring historic buildings. So as you know, the old library is a Carnegie Library. It was one of about maybe 2,500 or something like that in the world. And it needs to be repointed. So I'm working with Paul directly to try to secure that grant from the state to repoint the building, the old building. So that would be the first step I would take. I'm hopeful that my department heads and my staff can also be writing grants on a local level. I know that we're getting grants from like the council, the historical council, a few other places, the Library Foundation. I don't know. I can't speak at length about that because I'm only into this.
Of course, no. But I think the sooner the better, and I think it's great that you have your staff working on them also. Yeah.
But I do want you to know that I am actively pursuing this grant from the Massachusetts Historical Council and working with a grant writer to do it.
Very good to hear. So I look forward to we look forward to accepting it. So thank you.
Thank you, Council. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Paul, and welcome to the city, as my colleagues have said.
Thank you.
Perhaps you said it, and I'm not exactly sure because I was outside putting out a little fire that we had in the, not a physical fire, but a little fire. And I'm not exactly sure where you came from.
My career has been in the academic sector for 21 years. I was working at the Berklee College of Music.
So around the area, basically,
from
Massachusetts.
I'm from Boston. I live in Rockland right now, and trying to declutter my house and get it ready to move.
Yeah. Well, I'm not sure if you know this, or you probably do know, that Brockton is one of the more diverse cities in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And you had a conversation with the superintendent of schools, so I'm sure that she told you that close to 70% or over 70% of the kids in our public school system come from minority homes. Mm-hmm. And within those minority homes, a great number of them come from homes where English is not spoken as a first language.
Right.
What are some of the plans that you might have to diversify the library in a way so that we can actually tap into the needs of some of the folks in the community?
Well, the first thing I would speak to would be creating a more vibrant and a deeper ESL program. Malise does a lot of programming now, and I know that I've met people who have gone through that program who started off not knowing how to speak English at all, and now they're having successful careers. And I think we need to expand that, and we need to drill into that some more.
But what about in terms of, because I do a lot of work. Actually, I work with a lot of the programs that we have at the Cape Verdean Association, for instance, and we've got quite a few books that the organization might donate to the library so that you can kind of expand mm-hmm. the your collection of foreign books.
I would so love, pardon my interruption, but I would love to accept those books as a donation. We have we do have several collections, both in the juvenile, teen, and adult that are in French and Spanish and in Portuguese. I know that the Cape, I'm not sure.
Portuguese,
yeah, mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. So we are, and we have been before my time, and I hope to continue that tradition and to build on that tradition. So I would love to speak with the gentlemen or ladies that have these books and would like to donate them.
Yeah, because I think, when you look at the city and the fact that we are so rich in diversity in the sense, a lot of our organizations and buildings and agencies that we have in the city need somehow to reflect that. And sometimes it's nice to have, having somebody coming from visiting from a foreign country, but be able to go to the library and pick up something and, read a book or some information and stuff in another language. So I'll be willing to work with you on that.
Oh, I'm happy. Thank you. And the other thing I want to do is I want to start getting our Facebook and our Twitter and our advertisements in multiple languages as well.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. And again, welcome to the city. Thank you,
Mr.
Chairman.
Thank you, Council. Councilor Yaniri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Engel. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Welcome. I'm sure you do a wonderful job here, and I hope you enjoy your stay here in the city of Brockton. It's a great city, city of champions, and I'm sure you're going to learn quite a bit in the next few weeks and months as you take on this new challenge. I noticed, but I heard you indicate that, I guess, music's one of your passions.
Yes, sir.
And I don't know if you realize that some of the members here of the city council, they're in a group called Council Chords.
Well, you guys got to come and do a gig.
I mean, you might want to, you know, hook up the lead singer right here, and maybe he can take your, I know you've already been out in the community, but maybe you could go out in the community next Thursday at the Senior Center, and it's Irish Day, and sing along with them. What a way to go.
I don't think you want to hear me sing, but I'd love to come along and
but in any case, I'm sure they would welcome you, but I do want to again welcome you here to the city of Brockton, and if any time that I can take an appointment with you and sit and talk with you, I'd like to do that.
I would love it. I invite all of you to do that, and my schedule is like drinking from a fire hose at this point, so
great.
If you take the initiative, I will certainly respond. My intention is to hit every one of you at some point and have a one-on-one with you, but Ann's keeping me busy, so
that's great. Great to hear that. Thank you Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, without saying.
Any other councilors? Mr. Engel, first of all, I want to welcome you. I want to thank you. I think your background speaks for itself, so I appreciate that. I'm also really impressed because I've been on the council 12 years, and I always ask the directors about the history of the library, the Carnegie Endowment. When you go into the Lingos room, there's pictures of Andrew Carnegie, but there's actually a handwritten one in the corner on the right where he actually wishes the Brockton Library all the best in future endeavors. I think it was 1910 or 1911.
Yeah.
So I mean, I appreciate that. During budget season, I always ask the following. Relative to budget items, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has always been generous to the Library Foundation. It's my understanding to the Library and Association. It's my understanding in the last few years it's dried up a bit. So my thoughts are, would you consider revisiting that, and what other avenues would you look at relative to some foundations that might benefit Brockton?
Well, you probably know more about that than I do at this
okay.
point, because I haven't really learned a lot about
okay.
that. So my first
happy
thought
to sit down with you on
would
that.
Be to sit down and have coffee with you and talk about that.
Okay.
And then try to figure out how to get back into the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation.
Okay. Yeah, and we could maybe do that before the budget season starts, so that'd be great.
Yes.
And the other position is, what are your thoughts, because I think it's a great endeavor, interlibrary loan activities between other municipalities?
Lending materials?
Lending, yeah, through other cities and towns.
We belong to the Old Colony Library Network, OCLN, mm-hmm. and through that network, we already do share materials back and forth, and we have a free lending policy back and forth between any OCLN library, and we also lend statewide, so that we are already doing that. I think we can do more of that, and I plan on working with David Slater at OCLN to try to figure out ways of promoting it more.
Great, I appreciate that, and I do want to also recognize our elected colleague, Mark Lindy, who's one of the Brockton reps, Southeastern Region. I know you also spend yeoman's time relative to the Library Foundation, so Mark, thank you for being here as well tonight. Any other questions before us for Mr. Engel? If not, I'm going to entertain a motion.
Move favorably.
Second.
Second.
Thank you.
Motion was made. It was properly seconded. It's a favorable recommendation. Back to the full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, motion carries. Thank you, Mr. Engel.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. Madam Clerk, that passes favorably to the full city council. If we could go to number 7 on the agenda, please.
Resolve to invite Mr. Bill Carpenter, the mayor of Brockton and not a designee, to the city council to inform us as to the current status of all governing boards, commissions, and committees. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor. How are you?
Good evening, Mr. President. How are you?
Good, thank you. Thanks for being here. And I believe this is yours, Council Beauregard?
Yes, yes.
Do you have any statement before the mayor does?
Yes, I do. This is brief. I filed this for three reasons. One, because the people that serve on these boards, they are doing this on their own, you know, volunteering. I don't believe the public always realizes that. But in some instances, there's been some vacancies. We ran into some situations with the parking authority where they couldn't have a quorum, and so I'm very excited about the new members that are now on it. The other reason, for example, is we also have an empty slot on the library, and the other night the Board of Trustees of the library was rather sparse, and they again, you know, had a, how would I say it, they were at a point where they couldn't have a quorum. And I don't think that people realize that they can serve on these boards. And we have a lot of remarkable, talented people in this city of all ages and all backgrounds. And to me, the more we take advantage of this talent, the more advantageous it can be for the community. So thank you very much for this huge list. and I guess I'll let you go from there.
Sure. So if I could follow up on a couple of the council's comments, if that's okay, Mr. President. First of all, the parking authority, you're right. We did end up with two vacancies. The council just very recently approved two new appointments to the parking authority. I think they're really outstanding new members of the authority. One of the vacancies that we took on the parking authority was unanticipated. So we were in the process of talking to some folks about filling one vacancy when we were handed a second one with no warning. So once in a while that occurs, and as you said, Councillor, 99% of these folks are serving as volunteers in addition to all their other commitments. And it's been a, I think for all mayors and all city councilors, it's sometimes a little bit of a challenge to be constantly looking for and recruiting people that want to serve. And I think that when we came in 3 years ago, we came in with a commitment to not just fill more positions. There were a lot more vacancies when I took office than there are now, but also to proactively diversify many of the city boards and commissions. And I would like to speak to Councilor Rodriguez's comments a moment ago, but Nick, if you could hand through the clerk, I also have another handout for you regarding the appointments that we've made over the last 3 years. But I do want to first thank the city clerk for the handout that we handed out earlier. This was actually prepared. I asked that this be updated by the clerk for your benefit for tonight's conversation. So I do want to thank Clerk Zioli very much for having his people update that for us. Councilor Rodriguez just made a kind of a question or comment to Paul a moment ago about diversifying the library, the mission of the library, the services. And Council, I think that begins by diversifying the board. And we've done that pretty significantly. If you look at the four appointments to the board that have been made since we've been here, three of the four are from the city's minority communities with some really excellent representation. Dr. Polycarp, a member of our Haitian American community, who besides being a pastor has a PhD and is a published poet. Dr. Amina Pilgrim, a college level professor, another PhD from our city's Cape Verdean community. So I think in many of these boards and commissions, the diversification begins with the board or commission itself. And I think that the library just kind of came up from your conversation as a great example of that, because we felt it was important that all the various communities within the city felt as though that they would have a role in the future direction of the library. And I think perhaps, and Mr. Lindy could speak to this, hopefully you're very favorably impressed by Paul. Our recent appointments to the board were very involved in selecting Paul as the new director. And in the time I've had to get to know him over the last couple months, I think he looks like a real good selection right now for the future of the library. So I think sometimes people underestimate the importance and the influence of many of these boards and commissions. So I certainly appreciate your comments, Councillor. And the information that I gave out to everybody shows that since our administration has come in, we've made 93 appointments to boards and commissions in just about 3 years. So there's been a steady stream of appointments coming in front of the council. And as you'll see from the information regarding the issue of diversity, 54% of the people that we've appointed to boards and commissions and have been confirmed by the city council are from the city's minority communities. So I think over the course of 3 years, there really has been a significant and substantial change in the makeup of many city boards and commissions. And to your point, Council Beauregard, is that I think, and I felt this way coming in, and I feel even more strongly today, 3 years later, I think there are a lot of really good, really talented people in the city who want to serve the city, but they've never been asked. And so what we've tried to do proactively every single day, every time I meet somebody, sometimes in a conversation, I'll say, do you live in the city? And in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, I kind of like this person. I could use them on a board or commission if they're a Brockton resident. So, this is a work in progress. We do have a couple vacancies to fill right now. I can tell you we're looking at them very actively. Chief Galligan has requested that we fill an opening alternate spot on the ZBA, and we're working very actively on that right now. We also anticipate a couple of openings on a couple of boards and commissions, but they are by and large almost all populated, and we continue every day to look to try to expand and improve the pool of people that we have serving the city. So, you know, I am always open to referrals from counselors. So, you know, if you have somebody you think that could, you know, be a good fit on a board or commission, please, please send them my direction.
Thank you.
Counselor Barnes, followed by Counselor Azak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Mayor, good evening.
Good evening.
I just have a few questions. So I see this was updated as late as 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, February 16th. But some of the terms are still expired. How is that an update?
Yep. So, Counselor, you're right. And I think what's important to note is that just because a person's term is expired does not mean that they don't continue to serve.
Okay.
They continue to serve until and unless the mayor appoints a replacement. So in many of these cases, people are very willing to continue to serve, and at some point there'll probably be a reappointment coming. There are lots of different scenarios. We've got a few scenarios right now where people are willing to continue to serve, but they don't necessarily want to make a 3-year or 5-year commitment today. So they're happy to continue to serve, but don't feel in good faith they can make that real long-term commitment, and I'm absolutely fine with that. Quite honestly, we've got a handful of situations on here where some people have some really significant health issues going on, where it probably really doesn't make sense to reappoint them for another 3 or 5 years. However, out of respect to them and the work they've done for the city over the years and the contributions that they've made, if they indicate that they would like to remain on the Board of Commission, I allow them to remain on the Board of Commission, but that would be a situation where we would just use holdover status. So kind of every board and commission has its own story, and, you know, then it'd be right this minute, but anytime, you know, if you have a question about a particular board or commission, I'm happy to always have that conversation with you.
Okay. Thank you. And so I did have specifically about the Consumer Advisory Commission. What is that, and why is it empty?
I missed that one.
There are a couple. I mean, when we started out, if I were to show you...
Page three.
Yeah. I don't 100% know the answer to that one.
Okay.
It was looked just like that when I came in. Clearly, you know, when we came in 3 years ago, there were quite a few vacancies on quite a few boards, and I think that over the first couple of years, we did have to do some prioritizing as to what were the critical positions that had to be replaced as soon as we could. And then we've kind of grown and expanded from that, and you know, you've worked very closely with us on both the Diversity Commission and now the Women's Commission. And those were two boards that had gone completely silent. And last year we got Diversity within the past year back up and running. And now working together with you, we're getting Women's back up and running. And a matter of fact, my 8 appointments to Women's were submitted to the clerk for your next council meeting for first reading. So, you know, we couldn't come in on day one and address 100 and something positions on boards and commissions, but I think that we've really made some substantial progress. And as I mentioned earlier, every day I've got my eye out for someone that you know, is a city resident that might have an interest in serving and would bring some skill sets to the table.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilors, I do want to bring to your attention on page 5, there's a Scrivener's error. Relative to the Water Commission, Daniel Murphy, that did not expire last March. It actually expires the end of this month. That 16 should be year 17. I appointed him when I served as president in 2014, along with Kate Archer. So Mr. Murphy has not expired yet. And then Mr. Osgood had been appointed at the end of Mr. Cruz's presidency. So we do have one more appointment, and I will speak to Mr. Murphy relative to that point of information. Thank you. Any other questions? Councilor Ezak, you had a question.
Actually, I wanted to publicly thank all our board members and commissioners. They really are dedicated, and they are the mayor's appointees, and they work hard, and they really give back. There's a lot of times when meetings last a very long time. And there's a lot of work that's done outside of the meetings that a lot of us don't even realize. So I thank them. Thank you for their service to our city. And the other question the mayor answered, it was regarding the Women's Commission, mm-hmm. which I know, I thought we had already approved a few.
Well, we had a little bit of a false start because when I originally had hoped to get that back going with the council, after we started the process, it was brought to our attention that the commission didn't actually really exist anymore on the city's charter. So working with Councilor Barnes, she filed legislation that the council approved that recreated a women's commission, 11 members, 8 appointed by the mayor, 3 by the council president, I believe, Mr. President, all subject to the approval or the ratification of the full city council. And I can tell you, even though that's just being submitted now, we've been working on this for months and months. You know, we started from scratch, had to come up with 11 really good people that we thought would be a kind of a cross-section of the community and bring some different backgrounds and skills. You know, you don't want to put 7 people that are all exactly like each other on the same commission. You want to really try to have some people that have different backgrounds and talents and come from different communities within the city. And I actually think, and I haven't seen your final selections, Mr. President, but I heard a couple of the names. And I think we're going to have a really outstanding women's commission that's now going to take a leadership role on issues impacting women here in the city.
So the ones that we did approve before, that we realized that...
We started the process and then we stopped when legislative council and the clerk and the solicitor brought it to our attention that... I don't want to get too much into specifics, but actually over a number of period of years, some people had been appointed to a commission that really didn't exist anymore, and it kind of came to light when we went to revamp it and restart it. And so we got it right now. We took a step back with the help of Councilor Barnes, filed new legislation, recreated it, and now it's ready to go forward.
Very good. So my question really is the candidates.
It's the same people.
Oh, very good. That's
basically.
All.
It was essentially. It might have been 1 or 2 small changes.
There
but
were a few that were different or maybe didn't want to do it.
The vast majority are the same folks with maybe 2 or 3 changes, something like that.
So this point of information, the vote that was ratified is moot because the agency didn't exist, the commission didn't exist. So those people would have to come forward again.
Oh. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. President.
Council, I'm sorry, you done?
I'm all done.
Council Yaneri, followed by Council Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening, Councilor.
Just, I did hear Council Barnes mention something about the Consumers Advisory Commission, and I think that really fell to the wayside back under the end of the UNITS administration, to be truthful with you, and the beginning of Harrington's administration. There was never enough members anyways, and if I can recall, I served on it some many years ago for just a 1-year fill-in under the late Mayor Paul Studinski had asked me to fill into. That's how, you know, it was active back then, but we should really look at probably just trying to eliminate, to be truthful with, unless you feel there's a...
No, I'll be happy to work with the council on visiting that defunct and see if there's a, you know... I'll work with you on that. If you want to revitalize it, we'll go out and find some folks. If it seems as though maybe its usefulness has passed or there's a better way to do it, then
the budget
we'll
was
work
minimal
on it together.
And it was just it really and a lot of times the members that were there didn't show up. They never had quorums, history that I know of in any way. So you might want to just take a look at that.
Yeah.
The only other question I have for you, Mr. Mann, I go back to the Board of Assessors, Christopher Pike. I think he's been on for over a year now, or close to a year, has he not? And he's still under the Northeastern address, or?
We'll update that for you.
Yeah.
He lives on Ash Street, purchased his parents' home.
I thought he had gone there.
Yeah, yes. I'm sure.
Yeah.
So I think that's just a matter of, with this newly updated list, working with the clerk to, make some updates. But my understanding is he lives on Ash Street, purchased his parents' home.
Other than that, I mean, I think it's great that we do have this list, because there are some people that, you know, do ask me sometimes, are there any openings and, you know,
yeah,
different things within the city, so it does give us that way to look without having to call and see what is.
Yep. Be happy to take any referrals you want to send our way.
You know, do appreciate, you know, the work that's gone into it, and appreciate the boards and what they're doing, had straight of many myself, so it's not an easy task at all, but appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
Councilor Neary, just point of information, it kind of goes in tandem with what the mayor said. He's, you know, ready, willing, and able to sit down. Some of them we want to vet out. Also, you recall, I had filed a resolve under the previous mayor, and then Mayor Carpenter supported it relative to honoring certain people that volunteered. I talked about Mr. Murphy, right. John Murphy, late John,
right,
Murphy, 45-plus years,
right,
on the planning board. The mayor, ready, willing, and able to jump on that. I think we need to revisit that,
right,
and work with the mayor's office to honor,
sure,
those that served 25-plus years or whatever, unpaid volunteerism. So I know you and I talked about,
yes,
that offline,
yep,
as well. So.
And I think we should.
Yeah,
we
absolutely.
Should.
Yep.
So we'll come up with something. We'll work with the mayor's office, of course.
I think, Mr. President, just as I stand here listening to you, you know, perhaps Paul Sullivan might be someone
that
category.
It's probably at least a dozen people,
yeah,
that, yeah, Red would definitely be someone.
Sure.
Yeah, Bonnie Boyage. And there's quite a few of them. So, Councilor Yanary, are you all set?
I am. Thank you, Mr.
Okay,
Chairman.
We're going to go to Councilor Beauregard.
First of all, thank you, Mr. Mayor, for coming, and I'm glad we have this
There's
list.
No place I'd rather be on a Monday evening.
Well, that's good.
It's so believable.
And the idea was actually to...
I heard we were going out afterwards. Was I misled?
Money, no, because you're paid.
Yeah. That we were... You know, wanted people, first of all, to realize that there's that many boards in the city, what they entail, and again, as I mentioned, there's a lot of people that can contribute, young and old and in between. I will say that, yes, you know, being very involved with the library itself, I was very excited to see some young people. We have a young person on the city council that's been a huge contribution because of his background and his mindset, and to me, sometimes I don't think communities look to young people to contribute and as they're capable, and I'm just hoping that that's a consideration.
Mm-hmm.
I believe what you have to be 18 to serve, or at least
I would
to
assume
be registered,
so
voted.
No, there's no
there's no limit, so we could even have younger people, which would be a really,
yeah, life. Well, and I think, Councilor, to your point, you know, when we talk about diversifying boards and commissions, I'm not just talking about ethnic background, I'm talking about age and you know, men and women and all different groups of folks. So I think that is consistent with what we're trying to do.
So thank you. And now we know that we can submit, and some people out there that are listening, if you have an interest, a passion, and time and patience, then we'd like to hear from you.
Right.
So thank you very much.
Okay.
Council, you done?
Yes, move
Council,
favorably.
No, we're going to hold that for a second. Council Fowler had a question.
Yeah, and just, Mr. Mayor, my last comment is there have been some outstanding people, as I said to you, that have come through here recently, and it is hard to find people. We couldn't function, frankly, as a city government without these volunteers. The only suggestion I might make, because we do have a fairly comprehensive city website, and I have seen other towns advertise that, you know, they're looking for volunteers,
sure,
to serve on. Maybe we could have a page or something that says vacancies in boards and commissions, send the applications to you or the letter of interest to,
yeah,
you, because these are your appointments.
Yeah,
and then
quite often, Councilor, I think that my approach with folks has been to identify and find good people that have an interest in serving, and then sit down and talk to them about what all the various boards and commissions are that we have to see what it is they might be interested in. Because I do think that if a person has a particular interest or passion and they get an opportunity to further that or work on that as a volunteer on a city board or commission, we're going to get a really good board member. So I think that a lot of my approach in looking for folks has been finding good people who would like to help, and then sitting down and showing them what a number of various openings we may have are to see what might interest them.
So I
getting it on the website shouldn't be too hard. We really just got this updated version a couple weeks ago,
yeah,
but
we'll
work with the IT department to do that. We have used social media from time to time, encouraging people to serve on a board or commission, though.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Councilor Lally.
Can I plug a couple real quick right now? So, I mean, without getting into names, I am aware that We do have an opening coming up on the War Memorial Board of Trustees. That's a board that we basically completely rebuilt from scratch 3 years ago. And one member is not going to continue to serve, so we need someone good there. And I believe that we've been reviewing that particular ordinance, and we actually, by ordinance now looking at it, we may actually need a non-veteran for that particular spot. And I've also been made aware, and I haven't received anything in writing, so I don't want to use names, but I've been made aware that we have one or two members of the Conservation Commission that may be looking to step down. And, you know, Council, that's one that we've already done some work on. And, you know, that's one that's a little more work to find people with the skill sets and requirements that you brought forward last year.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Council Lally.
I'll be brief, I swear.
Do you have your library card with you, Jack?
You know. I do have one, though.
I'm sure you do.
I just wanted to thank you for, you know, fleshing out a lot of these boards, and I would be remiss if I did not echo Councillor Beauregard in a lobby for youth involvement in mm-hmm. these positions. I have seen throughout Massachusetts there are towns that do have 18-year-old, 19-year-old members of boards. It is, I think it is an important way to help engage the youth of the community. Knowing they can be a part of it, knowing they can have an impact, really can change the outlook they have on their community.
Well, we'll have you take the lead on that, Jack, okay?
I'll try.
All right.
Thank you, Councilor. Any other questions? Oh, Councilor Rodriguez.
Oh. I'll follow up to that.
Yeah. Councilor Rodriguez first.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Before Councilor from Ward 3, Ioneary, brought up the issue with the Consumer Advisory Commission, one of the things that I was thinking about is that we just recently suffered the passage of the new marijuana law in the city. I mean, in the Commonwealth, and you know, perhaps it's probably something that would make sense to bring back some sort of a consumer advisory commission to kind of look into some of these ideas and thoughts of helping us govern with some of these issues that come up from time to time.
I don't know. Maybe we should have a marijuana advisory commission.
And call it whatever you want
to call it.
That
could make for an interesting group of folks to serve. Seeing as there seems to be a lot of discussion about marijuana dispensaries lately.
Yeah, we spent a whole afternoon talking about this in the Public Safety Committee. I guess, to tag along with what Jack was
Can I just throw in one follow-up comment in there, that, you know, the marijuana dispensary thing, and the council really has the key role there. I mean, that's all about zoning from the city level. The only real input we have is around zoning. And I am, now that you mention, I'm putting the finishing touches tomorrow morning on a correspondence to the ZBA regarding a proposed marijuana dispensary at the mall. And I'll CC all the members of the council electronically, because I do touch upon the issue of the current overlay zone, and perhaps if there is going to be an influx of several more marijuana dispensaries, does it really make sense to put them all in one little pocket of the city? Maybe perhaps it's time to revisit it, but the point I will emphasize is to revisit it through the council and through the ordinance committee and build a consensus as to what we feel is the best planning for the city, and not fall into this trap of spot zoning.
Okay. In following up with what Council Lally was saying in terms of youth involvement, I remember back in the days with the Harrington administration, we came up with the idea of a mayor's youth advisory council, and I believe you still have that.
We still have it, very active.
So perhaps instead of looking into putting 17-year-olds in the licensing commission dealing with alcohol, it might be just a safer bet to enact some ordinance in the sense and create that committee as a regular functioning committee of the city itself, giving the mayor the appointment powers over that, but at least officially, because I remember when we first came up with the idea or the thought of the Mayor's Youth Advisory Council, quite a few initiatives actually came out of that that committee. The Mayor's Summer Jobs Program came directly from that particular committee. Some of the other involvements of the kids in the community came out. The stakeholders of youth issues that we came up with back then came out of that committee of kids. So perhaps enacting an ordinance in the sense creating a Mayor's Youth Advisory Council officially from the city standpoint, I think would take care of a lot of the issues that have actually been brought up by youth involvement.
Yeah, we can look at the model. Actually, our Mayor's Youth Council is very active. I do meet with them from time to time, and they're working very hard right now getting ready for this year's Youth Summit, which is coming up in early April, and we're reformatting it this year, and it's going to be kind of a hands-on learning type of project, and we're really excited about that. Mayor's Youth Councils exist in cities across the whole country. It's a model that's, so I think that if we were looking to formalize it a little bit more, I'm sure we could talk with National League of Cities and get some existing models from other cities. But we do have a full group. They're very active. They meet on Monday nights, get involved in a couple of community service projects. We've got the Youth Summit coming up, and I do pop in to see them once in a while just to hear what they have to say.
Yeah, but I'm actually thinking even beyond that. For instance, whenever an issue comes up in the community that has to do with kids or youth issues, to actually have the youth council take on those issues, specifically on those issues. Not just advise the mayor, but to advise the entire city and serve as a sounding board for the entire city in terms of youth issues. And I think it would cut back or cut down on some of the thoughts that we don't have too many kids involved in certain boards and commissions. But at least if we have, just like we have a diversity commission dealing with diversity in the city, a women's commission, why not officially have a youth advisory council or a mayor's youth advisory council as an organization for the city?
Fair enough.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Cianero, you had a follow-up?
I'm all set. Mr. Tebow's getting ready to fall asleep. So we're gonna,
yeah.
And the mayor's tired.
Any other questions? Councilor Beauregard?
No, let's recommend this favorably.
Second. Motion made properly. Second, a favorable recommendation. Back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, our motion carries. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Mayor.
You.
Thank you, councilors.
Madam Clerk,
thank
favorable
you.
Recommendation back to full council. We're going to go to agenda number 8, which is the final agenda item tonight.
Resolve to invite Executive Director of the Brockton Housing Authority, Thomas Tebow, to give the City Council an update on the condition of current properties in the city with particular attention to those that have multi-purpose uses. For example, resident and office space that does not include the Housing Authority. Invited, Thomas Tebow, Executive Director, Brockton Housing Authority.
Councilors, as you know, Mr. Tebow is a friend of the council. He appears here, as did the late Richard Sergi, who would appear here. And please keep in mind, the Housing Authority does not fall under the realm of the City Council in terms of the legislative duties we have or our funding. They don't get any money from us. They get it from the state and the feds. But I know that Councilor Beauregard wanted to have Mr. Tebow here to discuss it. I think he's ready, willing, and able to do the same. I know Mr. Texera, Brockton Housing Authority, board members here as well. So with that being said, Mr. Tebow, thank you for being here. And Council, do you have anything, or do you want Ms. Tebow to do an opening?
Well, I filed the resolve so that we could have this dialogue. And the beginning was, and I have been speaking to Mr. Tebow on more than one occasion. One is the misconception that Brockton Housing Authority is in fact part of the Brockton government and not its own entity. I guess I sort of compared it to the military base that's located in a town, but they have their own, their own entity within. So the idea was to communicate various information because our constituents live in these buildings and we receive information, and I believe oftentimes there's a lot of misinformation. So this was an opportunity for Mr. Tebow to again inform everyone in ourselves on anything that's going on, any other concerns, and just so clear the air and have this communication going, because it's such a phenomenal asset to the community, and there's so many people being served, and of course people waiting in line to be served. So thank you. I'll let you speak on
that. Thank you, Counselor. Thank you, Mr. Thibault. Do you have any opening or any information you want to share?
Yes, I do. Thank you, Mr. President, and thank you, Counsel Beauregard. Thank you, Counselor Nyerere. I'm a, you know, a 3 o'clock in the morning kind of guy, so I am getting tired. I do have a report that I'd like to share with the council. First of all, I'd be remiss if I didn't speak about my board. You spoke about volunteers. We have a very strong board. Two of my board members have in excess of 15 years tenure. My chairman, Tim Sullivan, has been with the Housing Authority since 1999. The vice chair, Ernest Pettiford, serves a great sacrifice. He's been with us since 2001. Prior to that, he was a vendor of the Housing Authority, so he had to give up all future business, and he did. My treasurer, Commissioner Texera, is here. Commissioner Texera, if you all know, runs the mattress maker over here and is also a landlord in town, has been a great addition to our board. Serves us well, is always there for my council, and has actually made some very great suggestions to save us money. We also have Janet Trask, who spends all of her time helping others, and Sandra Proctor, who is a resident, too. I know Councilor Studensky is very familiar with, but probably spends most of her waking hours helping others. I did want to talk a little bit about the partnerships that we've had with the city. I don't think we're like a military base. I think that's sort of a big fence around in the middle of your community, and we do feel that we're part of the fabric of the community. I was just going, I just jotted these down quickly today. We have a number of programs that we work with. The Community Policing for Elderly and Disabled program started under then Mayor Farwell with Police Chief Studensky. And this is a program where two to three police officers are exclusively assigned to the Housing Authority. Unless budgets don't allow, obviously, you have to move around there. And I think help make the Housing Authority property some of the safest in the city. That program goes on today. I don't know the exact date, Councilor Farwell, but I believe it was somewhere around 1994, 1995. We also work with, and he's not here tonight, he was the chairman of the Brockton Housing Authority Board, Tim Cruz, with the Neighborhood Infill Program in the Pleasant Prospect area. This was a program where there were a number of properties that were abandoned. They were dilapidated, they had to be torn down, and so there were vacant lots there. And after a couple of attempts at development, the Brockton Housing Authority became involved, and we built a number of houses there, a number of single-family houses, homes for sale. We still have a number of units that are in our possession up there. I think if you go up and you just look for the nicest houses in the neighborhood, you will see those are the ones owned by the Housing Authority. And that was in a partnership with the council at that time and mayor units. The Neighborhood Stabilization Program came along. We worked with the Harrington and Balzotti administration. The Neighborhood Stabilization Program came about because of the housing crisis of 2007. The city of Brockton per capita was number one in the country of foreclosed units. So the Housing Authority worked with the city, the state, the federal government to purchase foreclosed properties. We rehabbed them, and we are now owner, and we the landlords there. Again, I think you'll see some of the best units in the neighborhoods that we were working with there. We continue to work with the first time home ownership program. The council has on numerous occasions transferred parcels of land. We would then work with the youth build program and the Housing Authority. We would build a unit and we would sell it to a Brockton resident who was a first time home buyer. We constantly, and we continue to do annual cleanups. I know a number of you have participated. We've done them up at the old Zayas building, done them down in Campello, done them down on Shepherd Street. It's something that I know my kids look forward to every year. And then finally, working currently with the city, the mayor had asked us if we would participate in expanding our security cameras. We have done that. We have gone to an internet-based security camera program. In fact, this weekend there was a shooting down on Shepherd Street, and I know that the footage from
the Brockton Housing Authority cameras has been instrumental to the police in addressing the issue. So, again, we're proud of that and proud of our partnerships. Just to give a little bit of an overview, Council Beauregard, I really did something real quick just so people would find out a little bit about what the Housing Authority does. Now, most people know us by our buildings. We have 16 public housing complexes. There's 1,950 apartments in those. We have 100 scattered sites, and I did give you a listing in this report. 1,584 of the units are primarily one bedroom for elderly disabled. 366 are general occupancy. Those are for low-income families. 626 of our units are funded by the federal government, and 324 are funded by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. Others are funded simply by a pro forma. The rents pay for the units. We have three affiliated nonprofits: Brockton Housing Authority Development Corporation, Southeastern Mass Affordable Housing Corporation, and Montello Affordable Housing Corporation. Like most public agencies, we have experienced budget cuts. Just to give you a quick idea on the budget cuts, and I'm not here to have you give us any money. We've never done that. And in fact, if money goes, it goes the other way usually. Each year we have experienced a budget cut of an average of $855,000 for the past 12 years. That's about a $10.27 million shortfall in that time period, or an average of about 11% a year. We've also seen more dramatic cuts in the administration of our housing choice voucher program. And the most concern is the cuts that have been made to our capital budgets. That's the money that allows our buildings to be in good repair. Now, the Housing Authority has not just sat back and said, okay, there's cuts, we're going to have to cut back. In fact, we've never laid anybody off, and we've expanded programs during this time. And the way we've done that is by expanding our income streams. The Housing Authority has done many unique financing schemes, and I'll talk about those in 1 second. And we've also sort of expanded business so that we could make sure that the shortfalls did not negatively affect us. We have run programs or assumed programs for the Avon Housing Authority, Bridgewater Housing Authority, Hanover Housing Authority, Abington Housing Authority, Stoughton Housing Authority, Milton Housing Authority, the Hanson Housing Authority, and Beacon Properties. We've entered several solar power service agreements, which have significantly lowered our electric cost. We've entered into several energy service agreements. In fact, one allowed us to replace the doors and the windows at the Campello high-rise. That was about $4 million for that. We're doing a couple of new things this year that we believe will bring in about $7 million that will allow us to address the elevator issues that we've been having at the high-rises, replace all the rugs, and do some of the stuff at Hillside Village that needs to be taken care of. Admissions criteria, I have that in the report. I just want to let this council know that there are very, 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 very long waits for housing. If you are, in fact, I just met with our admissions director today. We have over 150 emergency case families on the two-bedroom list. That means we tenant about 160 units a year, including the elderly disabled. And most of those are elderly disabled. If you're involved in a fire, which is the highest priority, mm-hmm. you'll probably wait about a year to get an apartment. If it's a domestic abuse issue or a foreclosed property, it'll probably be more like 3 or 4 years. If you're a standard applicant and you're coming in and you just have a financial need, it'll probably be somewhere around 10, 12, 13 years. You can imagine what that's like for a woman with a 10-year-old. I did give you a list of the complexes that we have. You can take a look at that. I have to say I'm proud to be associated with the Housing Authority. We have about 100 employees who work hard every day to make sure that we are part of the fabric of the community. With that, I'll answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Thibault. Council Beauregard.
There's one that we wanted to cover, SMAC, what that stood for and how
sure,
you...
Sure, sure. So SMAC is Southeastern Mass Affordable Housing Corporation. It was started in about 1994. It was originally a mirror board of the Brockton Housing Authority. Through regulatory changes and money that came in that required our board to look different, it is no longer a mirror board. In fact, it's 11 board members, two of which are Brockton Housing Authority members. They own 42 different units, 17 different buildings with 42 units. Most of those came in under the state neighborhood stabilization program.
Thank you.
Thoughts, any other questions?
I'm going to defer to my colleagues.
Councilor Lally, followed by Falwell.
How are you?
Good, Councilor Lally.
I just wanted to thank you for the work you guys are doing. I know that I represent Crosby Gardens. I know that there were two things that came up, one actually on a Saturday, that you know, I reached out to you and the issue was resolved within an hour. So it really does speak very well of the Housing Authority and the care they put into their jobs. It was very thankful for your work.
Thank you very much. I ask that any of the councilors reach out to me at any time. My experience tells me the sooner I hear about something, the better. Oftentimes, people assume the Housing Authority knows there's a problem, and we do not. And I'll give you one example of that. I was at the Campbell High-Rise about 10 years ago. I was walking through the community room, and a woman said, you know, the pipe on the 10th floor is leaking. It's flowing out all over. And I looked at her. I said, oh, that's terrible. And then I turned to her. I go, am I the first person you're telling this? And she said, oh, yes. It's been flooding for about an hour. So, again.
Councilors, again, bear in mind, Brockton Housing Authority is not just recognized in the Commonwealth, it's nationally recognized. And we have such dedicated men and women that work there every day. And my experience with Mr. Tebow is he'll call you back right away. Yes. So thank you for bringing that up, Jack, and Councilor Falwell.
Yeah, good evening, and I echo all that's been said. You, without any embellishment, you have a wonderful staff, great board, business leader in the community, Janet Trask, Mr. Pettiford, all of the other board members. I guess my question is and you're not prepared to answer it tonight, but there's a push to have a lot of housing density increase downtown. And I can't think of a better group than the Brockton Housing Authority to consider a state-of-the-art mixed-use building where you might have commercial on the bottom floor, and it would be the type of commercial establishments that would cater to the needs of people in a public housing project, and make that part of the downtown urban renewal project for however many apartments it might be. And you may not be able to comment, maybe it's something that's been mentioned, but would the Housing Authority ever be interested in taking a look at the core area of the city and having a housing complex down there in close proximity to the rail station and enhancing the downtown area and giving perhaps the residents in that building some amenities on the first floor that would be commercial in nature and meet their needs? Is that anything that you could contemplate?
It certainly is. It's something not only that we could contemplate, but we have. We work closely with the city. So if the city leaders, city planners believe that that would be the best thing to do, we would be more than happy. We'd be excited to work with something like that. I can tell you one of the things that we're looking at, and we haven't quite got there, but on our state portfolio, there's not enough capital money to keep them in good repair. Not in good repair that way. They'll meet the state sanitary code, but not the amenities that you speak of. And there are some unique, innovative ways that you can actually rehab the existing units, add some fair market rent units, and have those provide for the amenities. So again, this is something that we would work with this council, our state delegation, obviously the mayor's office, the planning office, and do whatever would be in the best interest of the city.
And granted, we wouldn't get any property tax revenue from it, but sometimes you have to look beyond that and look at what might really work and make a difference. The other thing I would ask is, could you email us the name of the one person that we might want to contact when we do get constituent issues? Because we get questions about, when are they going to replace my rug? you know, you had an insect problem and people bring mattresses in that perhaps they shouldn't, and so that we don't have to bother you, if there's one person, maybe the director of maintenance or whomever it is, and that way we can channel whatever constituent issues come in, because this is your area and not ours.
So I certainly can do that, but do not feel that there's anything that you're bothering me with. Most of the time when you contact me, I'm simply putting it to the department that needs to be. But I certainly will give you multiple contact places. Councilor Lally spoke of a Saturday. I think that Saturday was Christmas Eve, if I remember right.
Last Saturday.
What's that? No, last Saturday was another thing, but... you know, these phones are wonderful. You can never get away.
Yeah. And I guess my last comment is that to the extent that it would help, if a resolve from the council to some federal or state agency would ever help you, I haven't seen any come in the last year or so, but I know that we would be more than willing to author something and pass it and endorse what you're doing if it would perhaps bring in additional revenue, because it's, you know, revenue enhancement is a team effort. It's not just your responsibility. All of us could help you, I would hope, and enhance the quality of life for our residents.
I appreciate that, and it would require the support of the council. If we do go to the federal government, if we go to unique financing mechanisms, they would still want to see the local support, so I appreciate that offer.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ezak, followed by Councilor Barnes.
Good evening, Mr. Thibault. Thank you for being here. Thank you. I have to say it's always a pleasure to work with you. Anytime I've ever had a question, or you're always there, and I have to say thank you for the elevators at Bel Air Tower. They were finally repaired, and they're beautiful, so thank you. I just wanted to stress, you mentioned a little bit about, you know, how that lady said you were the first person she told about that that flooding or leak. That's a problem we seem to have in the community, is that people, whether it's on social media or wherever it may be, they put the problems out there and they're not contacting the correct people to really take care of the problem. Because anytime, and I know if they addressed it or called your office or called us, we would stay on top of it and get it taken care of. But I just feel bad because sometimes things get blown out of proportion and they get put out there, and our constituents and then they say nobody's helping them, but it's like they're not contacting the right people. You can't put something out there. If they want something done, they really need to contact the right people to get their problems taken care of, and I can't stress enough about that communication. So thank you. I know anytime we've had any questions, you've always been there to answer them for us, so I appreciate that.
Correct, and I just to tag on to the communication issue. The communication issue is a lot more complex than I originally understood. Mm-hmm. We have a number of elderly people who are afraid to complain. They think we're going to throw them out, people who we would never throw out, but they're just afraid. We try to get that message across, meeting with them on a regular basis. There's also certain immigrant populations where you don't want to call the authorities, because in their country, the authorities aren't always the best people to call. So we're trying to make different linkages that way. So on a regular basis, we're touching a number of people, but there are populations that are just afraid to let us know. And it always bothers me when I hear that a person is not complaining because they're afraid they're going to get thrown out. Mm. Trust me, we do not do that, and we do not do it often. You have to do quite a bit. One thing, though, you do have to do, and this is for everybody, you have to pay your rent. but I appreciate that. We do meet with our resident advisory board once a month and try to communicate that way also.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes, followed by Rodriguez.
Actually, I almost said I was going to ask about the Bel Air elevator, but thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Thibault, I think it's important once in a while for us sitting in these positions to address individuals standing in your position. I know it's dinner time for some of us, but I want to acknowledge publicly the amount of help that I've gotten from you personally. I deal with a lot of constituents that, you know, the issues that you were just talking about, folks that do not understand how the system works, but I wanted, again, just to publicly say how I knew Mr. Sergi for quite some time, and we had a great relationship, but I just wanted to say that publicly, that, you know, you have actually taken the leadership of the Housing Authority and have personally been so responsive. Odd hours, at times that most people wouldn't think about calling you, but you actually have called back and you continue to call back. So I really do appreciate, on behalf of those poor folks sometimes that do not make the phone calls, but I just wanted to thank you publicly in front of everybody that's here and at home watching us for what you have done and been able to help me out since I've been in this position. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Any other questions for Mr. Thibault?
Well,
Councilor Beauregard.
Again, it's not a question. First of all, we want to thank you for coming this evening. The idea was, again, to open communication and inform people. And just as I suspected, you were going to tell us things like people don't report things or people are afraid. And we wanted that emphasis to be clear. You're now on the south side of Brockton and in the Sergi Building, and named after an individual that did much for the city. I want to thank you for coming this evening. I'm going to recommend this resolve favorably. I want to thank you for this, and I hope it's all right that we can turn around and bring this out to the community. And thank you again.
Thank you, Council. Motion's been made. It's been properly seconded. Favorable recommendation back to full council. All in favor, please raise your hand. All opposed, that motion carries. Favorable recommendation back to full council. Mr. Thibault, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have a good evening. Councilors, before we adjourn, a couple points of information, if we could, to report back to the constituency. This coming Thursday night, which is March 9th, at the Brockton Historic Commission or Society up on North Pearl Street, 6:30 p.m., Jim Benson, who's a local author, just drafted a book on the Strand Fire. And there's going to be an event that night, this coming Thursday night, 6:30. Of course, that goes into Friday morning, the 10th, at 10 o'clock here, the heartfelt and respected ceremony we have on an annual basis, sponsored by Local 144, the mayor's office. I know the city council is always well attended as well. And it is open to the public, and it's here at City Hall to honor those men that lost their lives. And then lastly, St. Patrick's Day and the Public Safety Mass, which is sponsored by the Brockton Firefighters Relief Association. It's this coming Saturday, March 11th at 11 a.m. It's at St. Patrick's Church, and it's officiated by Father Flavin, Jim Flavin, who was an icon here in the city of Brockton. You don't have to be Catholic to be there. It's a wonderful, wonderful event. It really is. It's a ceremony that really honors the public safety professionals that protect us on a daily basis. Anything else before us?
Mr. Chairman, a moment of personal
Counselor,
privilege.
Please, yes.
I would like to just congratulate this past weekend, actually on Saturday, we had a wonderful group of students from Brockton, Academy, from West Middle School, and from Brockton High School that participated in National History Day, which is an amazing event that I've had the opportunity to attend a few times. And they participated, and a group will move on to States, which is in April. So I want to congratulate all the kids that worked hard on their projects, their history teachers, and congratulate all the ones moving on and wish them luck.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, I'd like to take a moment of personal privilege since we're on the roll of all sorts of positives here. We had three positives take place last week. We had Read Across America, which many individuals participated in. And we'd like to thank, actually, the teachers that organized that. We dealt with Catherine Wedge. But just an example of all the positives, it was Dr. Seuss and was the theme, which he certainly sends a few positive messages and life lessons. And then the next day we had urban farming meeting, and that was quite the success for the meeting, the participation, individuals from all over the city, and there was a second one, and the report is going to be very impressive on seeing this community address issues as such as food insecurity and a better nutrition and how would I say it? Environmental concerns. And last but not least, it's been 1 year for the Champion Plan in the city of Brockton, and that was celebrated. And they gave us a whole breakdown of how many people they serve. And one of the things we wanted to highlight is that over 50% of the people served are not from Brockton. There are other communities that do not have these services, and the model is so well respected that it's being, copied throughout the state. And I just think that that's, three really great positives to the city. And along with that, Councilor Azak's, and That's one more for the city of champions. Thank you.
Thank you, Council. I had the honor to read to the second grade, great class, Mrs. Briggs and Mrs. Bouvier, Hop on Pop by Dr. Seuss. I read it last Friday, and it was very educational. No, it was a great, great, great time for the kids. It was really, it's an enjoyable. Council Barnes.
Yes, thank you. A moment of personal privilege, sure. Please. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to... first of all, personally thank United States Citizenship and Immigration Services, otherwise known as USCIS. They have actually taken they've taken their roadshow to Brockton Public Library, and just this past weekend they had a forum for the Haitian Family Reunification Program that specifically it's information specifically for Haitian families looking to reunify with their loved ones from Haiti to the United States. And I think there may have been, I'd say, about 30, 35 people that were represented there. And I just want to make sure that the community knows that USCIS, they will be doing a series of them in different languages. And this one was actually in French Creole, primarily. And they will be doing a Spanish-speaking and, I believe, a Portuguese-speaking program for these different services. And this is all in an effort to assist our immigrant community on how to engage with ICE and immigration and all, well, actually not ICE, but the immigration program. So I just want to tell people to be on the lookout for that, and please come out and get the information. USCIS, they are not the enforcement arm of immigration. They are just the petitioner, the grantors of petitions and the kind of clearinghouse for that. So I just want to thank them, and just again, they'll be at the library. Please be on the lookout for it, and to thank them for coming and taking an interest in Brockton's immigrant community.
Thank you, Councilor. Anything else before us? Seeing none, the meeting is adjourned. Have a good night, everybody.
Thank you.